Good evening, everybody. If you're glad to be here tonight, would you say amen?
Amen?
Wow, this is such a great looking group. I just want to know something in the house. If this is your first time to Kingsland Baptist, would you put your hands in the air? So glad that you're doing that. And then my Kingsland family, would you put your hands in the air? Yes. Now, I told the gang tonight that we get a little rowdy here in Katy, Texas. So don't let me down, people, okay? My name is John Boland. I'm the pastor of worship ministries here at Kingsland Baptist Church on behalf of our pastor, Ryan Rush, and our whole staff and church. What an honor. Are you glad to be here? Come on. I'm so pumped about tonight. We have been looking forward to this for months. Absolutely months. Would you just turn to someone on next to you and say, glad to see you here tonight. Would you do that right now? It is my great honor tonight to get to introduce these two people. All afternoon, I thought, how in the world do you introduce these two people? I mean, goodness sakes. And I could talk about their books, millions sold worldwide. I could talk about their music, millions sold worldwide, all their projects. I mean, how many of you have been influenced and ministered by their music, of show of hands in this place? We could talk about their church. How many of you been to Brooklyn Tabernacle and just been ministered there at the place? I mean, we could talk about so many things in their life. But as I was thinking this afternoon, I thought about the word influence. And I thought about the influence of millions, not just in Brooklyn or New York, not even in the States here in America, but literally worldwide. God has used them in ways that we understand some, but we'll never understand fully until we're on the other side of Jordan. And I can just speak from personal experience, the influence on my life. My dad was in ministry, music ministry, for 45 years. And I remember the day that he took us, our family, and we were going on a youth choir tour, actually, to New York. And I was 11 years old. And we went on Tuesday because we had to go to the prayer meeting at Brooklyn Tabernacle on Tuesday night. So we got there early. And I can just say this from personal experience. It was an Ebenezer moment in my life. And every time I've been there and every time I've connected with them and been in their presence and just let the Lord do what he does in their life, I leave encouraged and I leave ready to go back to work to equip what God has called me to do. And I know that so many of you feel the same way. Would you help me give a warm Houston welcome to Pastor Jim and Carol Simula tonight? Come on.
Good evening. Good evening. Good evening. Wow. After that introduction, I can't wait to hear what I'm going to say. That's amazing. We're so happy to be here. Let Carol say hello first.
I don't know. I just feel like I'm with family tonight. I don't know. This is like, I am with family, the family of God. And it's so wonderful to be here in Houston, Texas. I'm sorry, Katy. But we've come all the way down from New York City, and many of the people that you see behind me, they have regular jobs, and they take off their jobs to go on these trips. But we do it because we love to minister, and we love to lift up the name of Jesus. That's been our goal and our purpose throughout all these decades of ministry. And we love to praise the Lord and worship him. How many of you love to praise and worship the Lord? Do you know that's where he dwells? He dwells in the praises of his people. So that's what we want to do tonight. You know, you're going to hear these songs. Many of them are new, but we encourage you just to worship and praise the Lord, because you know what? We're going to be doing that when we get to the other side, when we get into heaven. It's going to be all about that. So we better do some practice right here, right? Before we go. But the Lord is good. He's been so faithful. I just was saying to everyone this afternoon that, you know, for decades I was directing a very large choir, 250 voices, and then we, for 16 months, were away from the church. The church was closed down for 16 whole months, and so when we came back a year and a half ago, we came back to a different church. We really did. How many of you came back to a different church after the COVID pandemic? And so many people had moved out of New York. So many people had fear. They didn't want to come back with a large group of people. So that really affected the ministry that I had for all those decades. And so when I came back, my husband said, well, you're going to have to do something here because the choir is gone. And I said, okay. So gathered up. These people became available, and so we have about 30 people singing in our choir now. No more 250. But can I tell you something? These people are precious, and it's my joy to direct them and to see how God is using them week after week after week. They have the spirit of love, the bond of love. They have the spirit of sacrifice. You know, they're not paid. We don't pay them anything, but they continue to minister for the Lord week after week after week. So I just pray tonight that they are a blessing to you and that your heart will be encouraged as you just lift up the name of Jesus and worship him and praise him tonight with them.
And as they sing tonight, what Carol said is so true. Jesus never died on the cross and shed his blood that we would entertain anybody with anything. Singing is not about entertainment or a warm, fuzzy moment. It's about encouraging one another, praising God together. So we don't want you to be a spectator. If you know any of the songs, sing along, clap along. But we're here to encourage you, be a blessing to you. And I'm very thankful to the folks running this conference and folks from this church who have made this all possible. So are you ready to rock and roll here? Are we ready to go? Let's put our hands together for the Brooklyn Tabernacle Singers.
Well, good evening, everybody. We are so glad you are here. The word of the Lord declares to let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. So we invite you to stand with us. We invite you to worship the Lord. As we lift up his name and we sing praise him.
Praise him in the sanctuary. Praise him with the timbrel and dance.
Oh, praise him
with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him for his mighty acts.
We praise.
Praise him in the mighty heavens. Praise him.
He alone is worthy. Praise.
setting of the saints. I will praise you, Lord, with all that I am, with all that I have. I bless the name of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, good evening. My name is Joanne Brown, and on behalf of our pastor and the Brooklyn Tabernacle Singers, we just want to say thank you for having us. It's an honor and a privilege, really, to be able to stand before God's people and sing or do anything, you know, God's precious people. So we are grateful to be here. We thank the Lord. And we just ask, like our pastor mentioned before, that join in with us. Let's all worship the Lord together. We'll be the leaders because we're up here, but please, don't just look at us and smile, but join in, clap along, sing along, enjoy the Lord. And the next song is I'd Rather Have Jesus, You May Know It. Just a nice little spin on it. Please, sing with us. Amen.
my side. He said he'd never leave me. Every battle he would fight. See, he's given me the victory. That's why I give him praise. I know he's working for my good. Yeah.
The battle falls out.
Oh yeah.
Even then, I will praise.
I'll praise him.
I can't figure it out. Even then, I will praise.
Hallelujah.
I know God is working for my good.
He's working for my good.
He has made a promise that he would.
Say it.
No matter the situation, I'll praise him.
This is my testimony. See, he made a way where there was no way. He's always on my side. He said he'd never leave me. Every battle he would fight. Yeah.
Thank you.
we just sing?
I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to
like you guys know how to sing or something. It's amazing. It is a joy for us to be here tonight to worship with you. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for worshiping with us. The greatest joy we have in our lives is worshiping the Lord. And to be able to do that together is just such a privilege. So thank you for being here with us. There was a time in my life when I went through the most difficult thing that I had gone through. And I was 30 years old, and I had two kids, and my daughters were 6 and 2 years old when their father passed away. And which is an anomaly, because I'm still just 25, so I don't know how God does that, but it's amazing. Thank you, Jesus. Just kidding. My daughters were 6 and 2 when their father passed away, and I thought that would be the hardest day of my life. But what followed that was a series of days of loneliness and anger and confusion and mistakes and mistakes. I became so focused on myself that I forgot that God was with me. I prayed, I didn't hear his voice. I called out, I didn't hear any answers. And I just feel like I was just treading water. And I don't know if you've ever been there where you feel like you're just treading water and you're getting to the next day because you're treading well. That's kind of where I was at. And my mom, I had moved in with my mom. She helped me take care of my kids. And my mom looked at me one day and said, let's go to the doctor. And we went to the doctor, and through a series of testing, they diagnosed me OCD, psychotic, which does not mean psycho, probably. That one's still out. No words from you, Landon. Severely depressed. They put me on 4 medications a day, and I took those medications religiously. The issue was I was raised Pentecostal, and while I was on these medications, I felt nothing. And being raised Pentecostal, we feel everything. Even when there's nothing to feel, like, we feel it. So that was a real problem, to feel nothing. I took these medications. I woke up, I went to sleep. I woke up, I took more medications, I went to sleep. That's how my days were. Felt nothing, didn't want anything. I wasn't looking forward to anything. I didn't know how to take care of my kids. My mom helped me. She took them to school. And after about a year of that, I looked in the mirror, and honestly, through decisions I had made and things that had happened to me, I didn't even know who I was anymore. I didn't even recognize the person looking back at me. And for the first time in a couple years, I was completely broken, and I said, God, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know how to get to tomorrow. Please help me. And Jamal, I remember this song that my mom taught me when I was a little girl. And it says, great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning.
I remembered that God wasn't mad at me for something I had or hadn't done, and this wasn't a punishment of sorts, but God loved me right where I was. And not only does he love me, but he had compassion for me. And I started praying and I said, God, forgive me for where I failed you. Forgive me for where I failed my family. God, if you'll help me, I want to take the steps I can take to be who you created me to be. To live like you created me to live. My mom and I went shopping after that, and then the next day after buying some fabulous shoes, thank you, Jesus. God is so good. He was working for my good, Brother Alvin, is what happened. I took my kids to school, and the next day I made them lunch, and they didn't die, and that was really cool. And every day since that day has been a step and another step and another step. And here we are, I'm completely depression medication free, and I get to travel around with my friends. Thank the Lord. I get to travel around with my friends and tell you that Jesus is exactly right for everything wrong in your life. And I know this is a house of worship, pastors. And I know that you're supposed to look like you have it all together. But if you're honest, we don't. Maybe some of you are just living day to day. Maybe some of you are treading and you came to this conference and you're wondering what it's going to look like when you get home. Can I encourage you to trust the Lord? Can I encourage you to talk to Jesus about it and let him handle your situations? Because he will. He's just that faithful and he's just that good. A few years ago, I fell in love with a man named Bean. My last name is Green. His last name is Bean. That makes me a... I have never been so happy to be a green bean in my whole life. And he's sitting right here on the front row. And sometimes we have to call Pastor Simba and get counseling more oftentimes than not. I get to today, and as a matter of fact, in the car on the way here, but I have the microphone, babe. You can just sit there tonight. Oh, no, he has a mic. It's not the time. God will turn your life around for good. God will give you the desires of your heart, and even when you think like you can't go on, he's just that faithful. He's just that good. And that's what we want to sing to you tonight. Every tear. Impossible.
You may be seated. So I'm up here really at my own request because I understand that the people who are conducting this, Worship 3217 Music Houston, to do this conference, which I was at the reading today, and I saw all these ministers of music, people involved in church music, I saw them drinking it all in and looking for music that will bless their congregations. And that's important because we're all on the same team. You all are aware that there are no denominations, right? No, did you get that bulletin? No, I'm serious. You're understanding there are no Baptists to God. There's no Assemblies of God. It does not exist. I'm getting an amen there? Okay. All these names we make up, Nazarene, Lutheran, Evangelical, Pentecostal, they have absolutely zero significance to God. The Bible says there's only one Lord, one faith, one baptism, but it begins by saying there's only one body. We are it. Can we praise God that we're in His one body? So, that's why this is so important, because if you're blessed, I'm blessed, and hopefully if we're blessed in Brooklyn, you're blessed, because this is not like sports and teams and playoffs. This is the one church of Jesus Christ. What a mess we've made of this thing with all of our fences and divisions and agreeing on 99% of the Bible, but we're going to fight to the death over 1% and separate and break God's heart. Oh, how precious it is when brothers and sisters dwell together in unity. Amen? So, that's why when I learned of the need of this conference, the financial need of this conference, and that they were going to take an offering at the very beginning, because you got to pay the bills. They have to pay the bills. Look, we're just visiting. We've been invited. We just want to be a blessing and serve. But when I learned that, Landon will tell you, I made a suggestion. I said, if I can help, do not take the offering at the beginning, because the people haven't even sat down, heard any of the music, and now you're taking an offering, correct? And if you're from Brooklyn, people go, get out of here, will you please? In other words, you got your hand in my pocket before you even sang a song. So that's sideways. So we decided, I asked and said, could we take a break in the middle? And if they're going to take an offering, let me take it. And they said, yes. I really respect the people doing this. So these people, we're not asking for anything from this offering. These people have taken off from their jobs. Some of them work for the church, others. They've lost, they're here sacrificing. So we want to sacrifice for this conference. We want to give an offering. Do I get a witness here? Do I get an amen? So we're going to take an offering. I'm going to pray. They're going to keep singing. Lynette's going to come up and sing a song of a whole different mood and tempo. But come on, they're going to pass some baskets. Come on up, ushers who are here. I've never done this here. We haven't taken a physical offering in a couple of years, right? Yeah. So just hold it for a second, and then we'll pass the baskets. So let's pray. Lord, you know the needs. You put it on people's heart to have this conference. People can come in here free and enjoy the music, and we can encourage each other. God, please, in Jesus' name, meet the needs of this conference. Supply, you said in your word, my God is able to supply all of your needs. So God, do what you promised. We pray and we look to you in Jesus' name. Let the people have a spirit of liberality and faith in Christ's name. And everyone said, amen. Thank you very much.
Thinking about time, and where does it go? How can I stop my life from search my heart. Don't let me stray, I just wanna stay where you are. Cause all I got is one shot, one try, one go around in this beautiful life. Nothing is wasted when everything's placed in your head. We're singing.
Such a blessing to be in the house with just people who love to worship. It's, you can feel it. Oh, God is in this room. Thank you, Jesus. Hi, I'm JC. Sorry, I'm JC. I'm obviously one of the singers here at the Brooklyn Tabernacle. Yeah, it's a really big blessing to be here with you all. When they asked me to speak today, just a little bit about this next song that we were going to be singing, a verse came to my heart pretty much immediately. The song is called I Will Not Fear, and this verse came to my heart. It's Psalm 37, verses 23 through 25. You've probably heard it. A man's steps are established by the Lord, and he takes pleasure in his way. Though he falls, he will not be overwhelmed, because the Lord holds his hand. I have been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous abandoned or his children begging for bread. Amen, right? Just the word of God alone. One time I was talking with a mentor, a really strong woman of God, and I was like, how do I learn to trust God? What does that mean? What does it mean to trust God? How do you do that? And she said, anytime that you're filled with fear, you remember the picture of Jesus hanging on the cross. If he sacrificed his son for us to enter into holy communion with him, what more wouldn't he do for you? The man who placed the stars, he spoke them into being, that gave you breath in your lungs, he holds the future. He holds everything. The commandment that's most spoken in the Bible is do not fear. Do not fear. That is a command. Do not fear, for I am the Lord. Everything that may come against us, And when situations may actually look like a crashing wave that's going to take us out, when you're like, no, 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 this is the one. This is the one that's finally going to take us out. I feel like a lot of us felt that during COVID. Like, what's going to happen after this? Is the church going to come back? Is God going to be faithful? You remember Jesus hanging on the cross. You remember what he did. And there's that old song. You guys know it. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, life is worth the living. Just because he lives. We don't need anything else. Even if we forget the things that he's done in the past, we can remember life is worth the living just because he lives. There is no more fear just because he lives. Hasn't God been good to you? Hasn't he been faithful to you? Oh, I'm so thankful for the goodness of God and where I stand. And so I hope you remember and you heed the words, do not fear. Do not fear, for I am the Lord. He holds you and he has you. Join us in this next song called I Will Not Fear. And I pray that you let those words wash over you and you remember his promise to you that he's got you. Amen.
I always trust you, Lord. Christ the solid rock I stand, all the ground is sinking. Yeah. All the ground is sinking. Can we sing that one more time? On Christ. On
Christ the solid rock I stand,
all of the ground is
sinking sand.
Yes, it is. I haven't always stood on the rock. I spent a lot of my life standing on sinking sand. Am I the only one? Anybody know what I'm talking about? I just want to tell the story real quick. I wasn't going to say it, but I got to tell you, you know, what this ministry means to me, what your ministries mean to people. Those of you who are involved in ministry, you may never know. You may never know what impact your ministries has on the lives of people that walks into your doors. I first went to Brooklyn Tabernacle over 40 years ago. That's 40, not four, 40 years ago. And I was a broken guy. I grew up in church, and I didn't want anything more to do with church. My life got all messed up. It was all my fault. And I stopped going to church. I didn't want to go to church anymore. I didn't like predominantly black churches because I thought they were too emotional. I didn't like predominantly white churches. I thought they were too dead. I was an equal opportunity hater. I hated them all. All of them, I hated them. And I don't have time to tell the story, but my sister strongly encouraged me to go to church. She told me about this church in Brooklyn, New York, on 290 Flatbush Avenue. And I walked in the doors of the church, and the choir was singing songs like I had never heard before. I was used to a different style. Pastor Simler was talking about different denominations. I came from a different denomination. There was a different sound, and I saw people. This was back in the late 70s, early 80s. We were having race riots in Brooklyn. I walked in, and I saw people of all different races in this church. I'm like, what in the world's going on here? I didn't think that people of different races could really worship together. I thought, wait a minute. Black people clap on the 2 and 4. White people clap on the 1 and 3. It can't work. It's too confusing. And I'd sit up in the balcony and I'd hear the choir sing. Carol would direct the choir, singing these beautiful songs. Pastor Simler would get up to preach. Pastor Simler, can I tell him what I thought when I heard you preach? Okay. So where I grew up, the preacher would kind of tune up and hoop when he preached. Pastor Simler, it was different. Because where I grew up, the preacher would go, well, I can't get no help in here. And when Pastor Simler got up to preach, he never hooped, not one time. But what he said pierced my heart. Watching the people worship, and I ran out of the building, and I kept coming back, and I kept coming back, and I kept coming back. And a year or so later, I found myself going to an altar, and God transformed my life. And you know what? That was over 40 years ago. And I've seen good times and bad times, just like you. I've faced highs and lows. I've lost people that I love dearly. I lost all my family, all of them. Prayed God would heal them, and none of them. But you know, they're not healed on this earth, but they're complete in the presence of God. So all those things, all that sinking sand I was standing on, I feel like Paul in the Philippians, the 3rd chapter, where he says, forgetting those things which are behind, what have you faced in your life? What has kept us from moving forward in God? What is it that we're holding to? The pain, the hurt. I know there are issues of life. I know there is. But I also know what Philippians, the 3rd chapter, says. Forget those things with God's help. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching for those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God, which is in Christ Jesus. I'm not what I want to be, but I'm not what I used to be. I'm changed. I'm transformed by the power of God. That's why we say, on Christ, the solid rock, we stand. All other ground is sinking sand. I won't go back. Set my sight towards heaven. Look to the hills from which cometh our help. Sand.
I've been changed.
Yeah.
I just wanna speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just wanna speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul.
In the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains.
Jesus in the over every heart. Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Oh, lift your voice.
Shout Jesus from the mountains and Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Thank you, singers. They're going to come back and do a reprise. How do you say it? How do you say that word? Reprise? Thank you. In Brooklyn, we go reprise, you know? So, again, it's so great to be here. I just want to leave you with a verse, and maybe we can pray a little bit. You know, God oddly says in the Bible, which tells us a lot about how Christianity is supposed to be, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Isn't that odd? Not preaching, not even singing. And yet what Carol said is true. He inhabits the praises of his people. But there's something about coming to the throne of grace and telling God what we need and receiving from him that is just, it pleases his heart. Like a parent with their child. The child's in trouble, the parents can help them, and that brings such joy when the parent, when the child comes in faith asking. So let's just, I want to talk to you about something that has affected all of us always in spiritual warfare, but especially since the pandemic hit. Jesus said in John 10:10, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly, or have it to the full. Listen again, he's talking about Satan now. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but on my part, I've come that you might have life in all of its fullness and all of God's purpose for it. I want you to notice that before Satan tries to kill and destroy, he steals. He's a thief, the master thief. Many years ago when we were in our previous facility, it hit me one Sunday night. I just wanted to find out who were real New Yorkers in the audience because we get a lot of visitors, but I want to find out who were true blue New Yorkers. So I asked them, Alvin, I said, how many of you here have been ripped off and robbed of something? Because if you've been robbed, that qualifies you as a true New Yorker. I have one associate pastor, he's had his car robbed from him 5 times. Years ago, Carol and I were living in a certain spot in Queens, and I had my airbag stolen from me 2 times by the same guy, I'm sure. He broke in and just took the airbag because at that time, crack addicts were using airbags for a quick turnaround, get the money that they need to satisfy their next fix on crack. This was before all the other stuff that's out there now in the street. So thievery is a common thing. You probably have stuff stolen even here in beautiful Texas, right? But Satan specializes, notice, in stealing. I'm reminded just of a quick story in the Old Testament where David, who went through all kinds of situations, before he's crowned king, he's on the run from King Saul. He ends up living with the Philistines, which is odd since he was the one who defeated their champion, Goliath. He's living with the Philistines. They take him in, protect him. He's ready to go to battle with them and against the Israelites. You can't make this stuff up. And then some of the generals turn to the king of the Philistines and say, yo, we can't go to fight with David on our side. He'll turn. He'll turn on us. Then we're going to be in a mess. This is David, you know, like, yo, king, remember that big song they were singing? David, Saul has slain his thousands. David his, that was a big hit back then. That won a Grammy. That won a Dove Award and a Grammy, in fact. And so he tells David, you got to go back. And David bickers with him, but to no avail. He has to go back with his men. He's got 600 men that are living with him with their wives. They go back to Ziklag where they live. And as they approach the town, they see some smoke. They start to pick up their pace. They start to run. And there they find out that Ziklag, where they had left all their wives, children, and all their cattle and all their belongings, has been burnt to the ground. They don't know that the Amalekites, a kind of raiding band of warriors, the Amalekites in the Old Testament were always anti-God. Always God had declared war against the Amalekites. Well, those warriors had come in, and while David was out trying to fight with the Philistines for them, they have stolen everything. The men who were tough guys that hung with David, they begin to break down in their nerves and begin to cry because these were difficult days. You think it's bad now. Imagine back then, you don't know where your 14-year-old daughter is. Or your son, or your baby, or your wife. And all the belongings are gone. So they begin to cry and cry. And they actually get so mad. You know, when you have a lot of grief, you turn on many times people who are close to you. They turn on David. And they talk about stoning him or killing him. And David, the Bible says, it's at the end of 1 Samuel, if you want to read the story tonight, David goes to God, and the Bible says he encouraged himself in God. A lot of times when you're back up against the wall, nobody can help you but God. You know, God. Like God. Not the pastor, not the preacher, not a counseling session. Like G-O-D, God. So David gets his strength back. And they go, what to do? So quickly, he prays and he says, he inquires of God, another wonderful practice. Instead of trying to depend on his IQ, he depended on God's direction. So he said, God, should I go after whoever did this? He doesn't know who. And if I go, will I find them, catch them? God says, I'll lead you. I'll help you catch them. So David takes off with the men. They're out in the desert somewhere trying to be led by God after these people who have robbed them of everything. And they find this Egyptian slave in the sand, just about dead. And they go, who are you? I'm an Egyptian slave. So who were you working with? I was working with the Amalekites. So what's the deal with them? Well, we were raiding a bunch of towns. I was with them. In fact, we knocked off Ziklag and burnt it down to the ground. David said, no, did you? So swear to me, lead them. Lead me to them because I got to get to them. So the Egyptian slave is smart and he says, all right, I'll lead you, but swear to me you won't kill me. He says, I won't. So he leads him, and there's a whole story. And the Bible tells us they end up on the top of a hill, and they look down into the valley. And what's in the valley down below? But all the Amalekites celebrating, drinking Dr. Pepper or whatever they drank back then, and just having a party, and with all the wives, all the children, all the cattle, everything. And the Bible says there at the end of 1 Samuel, David goes down. And for something like 12 hours, he fought with his men against the Amalekites. And it says this, he recovered every wife was recovered, every child, all the teenage kids, all the cattle. Not only that, but he ripped the Amalekites off of their possessions. Like the Bible says, he makes us more than conquerors. We just don't win, we more than win. And that was the day that David found out for the first time, which is often found in Scripture, that God recovers stolen property. Look at me, everyone. God recovers stolen property. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. So let me ask you something. Satan is a thief. What do you think he's interested in? I got some credit cards in here. You think he's interested in stealing your credit cards? No, that's a common identity theft. Stealing credit cards is a common thing in New York and everywhere. He doesn't want your credit cards. He doesn't shop where you shop. He doesn't want your house. Keep your house. He doesn't want your car. He doesn't need wheels to get around. Well, he's the thief. He doesn't want your money. You got a lot stored up? Keep it. Spend it. Save it. Whatever. He could care less. But yet he's the thief. And his target is us, God's people. Everyone everywhere, of course, tries to steal their souls. But even among Christians, he's a thief. So what would he be interested in stealing? Well, let me name a couple of things so that we can see that Jesus can recover stolen property here tonight. I'm serious. We didn't come all this way here just to beat our gums. We want to see God do something tonight. How many want to see, I don't care how long you've been serving the Lord. How many want to see God do something new in your life right now, tonight? Lift up your hand. Come on. Okay, so how about this? To the church at Ephesus, Jesus wrote in Revelation chapter 2, I know your work and your labor and all this, and I know you work hard and you're good on doctrine and everything, but you've lost your first love. Well, where would your first love go? Hello, wake up. It was stolen by the thief. Well, does that not happen to pastors like me or ministers of music or Christians? Yeah, you're doing what you do, but you lost your first love. He distracted you. He got you worldly minded. He got you whatever, disappointed, caught up in racial tension, politics. What a bunch of nonsense has been going on for years. The racialization and the politicalization of everything in the church is a huge tragedy, is it not? Like Democrats are the answer. The Republicans are the answer. Hello? How could that possibly be? They need Jesus. And yeah, let's say amen. They can't solve their own problems. How in the world would they solve our problems? Listen, hello, listen. America can't be better than Americans. France can't be better than French people. Puerto Rico can't be better than Puerto Ricans. But no one can change, no politician can change one heart. Only Jesus can change a heart and make a better person. This is a huge distraction from the enemy, and the love of most, Jesus said in Matthew, will grow cold because the days will become so evil. So maybe you're here today, and that tenderness, that love for God's word, remember those days when you used to read the Bible all the time? Now you're on the phone and you're busy. I know you're going to tell me you matured and you've gotten like grown up now in the things of God. No, no. Don't con yourself. We lost our first love. Maybe you've lost your first love for the Lord. You know, you listen, I've been watching my wife do this. She's amazing how God keeps her going, how she keeps having that fervency and that love to do the work of the Lord. The worst thing is when you just punch in and punch out. It's a job. If it's just a job to you, you ought to get out quickly. Because at the end of the day, you have to stand at the judgment seat of Christ. All of us, Carol and I, Alvin, everyone, Taranda, we're going to stand at the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of the quality of our work. Not that we put in the hours, but what kind of fervency did we have? Dedication. So that's something Satan's really interested. Keep your money. He doesn't care about my car or whatever. But first love, now that's a thing. How about some of you with your calling? That's the thing he loves to steal. Your calling. Some of you are just going to church on Sunday. You're not involved in anything. Well, that can't be. So let me get this straight. Jesus died on the cross so you would sit in a building once a week. All right, so let me try that on again here. Jesus went and suffered and went through all of that so you could say, well, praise God, I'm in church every Sunday. I mean, what Bible are you reading or not reading? There's a call on your life. We're all members of the body. You have a function, my friend. Ma'am, you have a function in prayer, working with children, going to shelters. You know, we have 40-some ministries in the church, and I met some of the most, I admire these people. They're in our church. They call me pastor, but they don't know how I admire them. They just went for the Christmas show, one of the Christmas shows. They went to three or four of the really bad shelters, one domestic abuse shelter, and they brought in all kinds of people for one of our Christmas shows. And another group were working, bringing in children from Angel Tree. Their parents are incarcerated. And here they are feeding the children in our church after the performance and giving them presents. They wouldn't get a present the whole year. What are you talking about? How would those kids get a present? These people, never on the platform, never preach, but they found their calling. And they're not letting Satan rob it from them. Come on, you know about people like that. Maybe you're one of them. All on fire for God, and you're going to do it. And now it's like, no, I'm tired. Now, because of the pandemic, people don't even go to church. They say they're watching it, but no creo, I don't believe. Am I right or wrong here? Am I talking right? So for you, you have a part to play. You can't let Satan rip you off. That's horrible. But you got to be humble enough to say, yeah, I'm getting ripped off. The thief comes to steal, not kill and destroy. First, steal. He wants to take the ministry from Alvin, the ministry from Carol, from me, discourage us, distract us, get us involved in every kind of silly thing. Why? Because he wants to rob our calling. He hates when Christians are doing what God called them to do. Can't stand that. Keep your money. He'll give you more. You'll get so distracted counting it that you won't be busy doing God's work. Let me think of some other things here. As I close, if you would come, Jamal. How about this? I have never met more depressed people who come to church than I have in the last 3-4 years. My wife and I got trapped in Florida on March 8, 2020. We went down for 5 days to just be away. The only home we own is in Florida, made possible by my parents many, many moons ago. And we rent an apartment 270 steps from our church in downtown Brooklyn. That's where we live. So we tried to get to Florida. We went for 5 days. It ended up 16 months. Because the church got shut down. They said, don't get on an airplane, Pastor. The church is shut down. The schools are shut down. The banks are shut down. There were spikes in New York that were just horrific. So while I'm down there, I'm talking to pastors and meeting Christians. The discouragement level, the joy that had been stolen. How can you do the work of the Lord without joy? Listen, the joy of the Lord is our. So if you lose your joy and that's robbed from you, you're weak. Show me one strong Christian who's not filled with joy. You won't find one. The sign of a strong Christian, they're filled with joy. Not psyched up, not hyped up, not on Red Bull, on something better than that. They're happy in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, and maybe you're here today and you just, your joy is gone. That bounce in your step. That's so important. You lose that. What kind of testimony are we to people if we lose our joy? Oh yeah, try Jesus and you're totally depressed. What a great advertisement to the world. Like, come be depressed with me and to my church. First Church of Depression at Katy, Texas, yeah. So, and I know I'm not trying to talk stupid here. In other words, we go through things. Things are real. But Paul says, Read 2 Corinthians, all the stuff he went through. In trouble in the city, trouble in the country, beat, left in the ocean, deep. Beat on the back, 39 lashes a couple times. Stoned, left for dead. And he never mentions anything about quitting or being discouraged. Maybe he had resources that we're not availing ourselves of. Now we just have a pandemic, everybody wants to quit. Am I right or wrong? Because we've got the victim mentality. I'm a victim. No, Jesus was the victim. He died on the cross for you and me that we might have life and have it more abundantly. So I'm not trying to be light about these things because we've gone through difficult things. Carol and I have gone through difficult times. But my goodness, we have Jesus. Can't let Satan rob your joy. He's a thief. But Jesus can recover your joy. He can recover your calling today. He can recover that first love, that enthusiasm. I meet ministers all the time. I pray all the time as I see people that inspire me and then some people I left. They're empty suits. Put money in their head, they'll give you a sermon. But they're no more caring about the congregation than they are the man in the moon. They're just going through the motions. Singers, the same thing. In fact, some of you that are involved in music, that's a real trap because music is so powerful. You can get up doing it like a machine rather than a man of God, a woman of God. You got to have that love, that fervor. Lastly, maybe you have a son or daughter. My wife and I went through this many moons ago, our oldest girl. Got separated from us, got separated from the Lord, and ended up just out there. And it was hard. In fact, my wife wrote that song, He's Been Faithful, right when she had surgery. Chrissy was away from God. We were at the lowest moment that you could imagine. And God gave her that song in a hospital room. And she began to sing that He's been faithful. It's hard when your kid is away from God or your grandchild, but don't play yourself, as they say in New York, don't play me. Don't play yourself. If your son or daughter is away from God and not living for God, I'm asking you now, who's going to go after them? David went after what was stolen and he recovered it in the name of the Lord. Who's going to go after in prayer and in love and intercession? Who's going to go after wayward children if not us, parents? We know what that's like. We went through a 2.5 year long nightmare. Nightmare, capital N, nightmare. And then God, in answer to prayer, brought my daughter back and she regained her senses. But God gave her a dream while the church was praying and she knew it was the Lord warning her. And she came back, now a pastor's wife in Chicago. So God recovers stolen property. Can we all say amen to that? But listen, last thing I want to say to you. Listen, it's not about, singers, come on out. It's not about slogans. You know, Christianity's become like, God is good all the time. Boom. God is good all the time. I mean, like, okay, I got that. But, you know, you got to get into the bottom of your heart and say, where am I? And God help me. He'll help you. He'll help me. How many know that if we come to the Lord and say help, He will always help us? How many believe that, right? So what is Satan trying to get you to do? To be too proud? To be too, fronting in front of people? No, everything's fine. And thus he cuts us off from that the throne of grace where we can receive mercy and grace. Always God will help us. So let's pray. Bow your heads with me. Anybody here, while I was speaking, the Lord put a little tug on your heart. And you say, Pastor, listen, you're not my pastor, but you were speaking the word of God. And I can see now what Satan's trying to do. I need to recover some stolen property. Maybe it's a son, a daughter, a grandson, a granddaughter. Maybe it's joy. Maybe it's peace. Maybe it's that fervor, the discouragement has set in. But you know that only Jesus can get you back where you need to be. Just stand right where you are so I can pray over you. singers can pray over. Just stand right where you are. Pastor, include me. I want to see God recover me. That's it. Just stand right where you are. Nothing to be embarrassed about. My goodness. We're dealing here with important things. I don't want to stand people be wondering, what's wrong with her? What's wrong with him? Come on, that's the last thought we have. We've all been there. Alvin shared his heart. Taranda opened her soul. I'm telling you, Jesus recovers stolen property. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life. I'll recover that. I'll do it. You don't have to strain. You don't have to worry. You don't have to fret. Anybody else want to stand? And we'll pray. Those who are standing, come to the front. Come on, get out of your seat here. We'll have an old-fashioned time of prayer. That's a good idea. Start to sing that, will you, singers?
You are holy, holy. Lord, there is none.
Down from the balcony. Come on down if you stood. Come on, we'll wait for you.
There are holy, holy glory to you, my Lord.
Now sing these words. Sing the song. Jesus, thank you for loving us. These songs have been like sermons tonight. You've been faithful. I won't go back. I will not fear. You are with us. I lift up every brother and sister that's standing in the front here. You know what's been robbed from them. You know what Satan's trying to do. So, Father God, in the strong name of Jesus Christ, I ask you, God, to start tonight, Lord. Recover stolen property, Lord. Bring back fervor. Bring back first love. Bring back inspiration. Bring back joy. Bring back peace. Bring back that daughter. Bring back that son. Bring back that granddaughter, that grandson. We don't care if they're in jail, God. Reach them in jail. In a drug den, wherever they are, God, reach them. Because you promised when we call, you would answer. And what you've done before, we pray you'll do it again. So we're going to worship you now. We haven't seen one thing happen, but we've asked. And we know that if we ask, you hear us. And we know that if you hear us, we will have the things we have asked from you. So in the mighty name of Christ, I proclaim recovery of stolen property. Come on, put your hands together with me. Everybody, clap. Recovery of stolen property. Everybody stand. Sing this verse with us. You are holy. Sing.
You are holy.
Sing.
Sing now.
I'll sing. Sing loud.
I'll sing.
more time. Lift up both your hands. Lift up both your hands and sing. Coming back. The children are coming back, Lord. The children are coming. God, write, register every tear from every eye that you see. The joy is coming back. The calling is coming back. The peace, the fervor, the first love, Lord. We bless your name. We bless your name. Lord, thank you for the privilege of Carol and I and the singers being here. And thank you for brothers and sisters in Christ. We're so happy that there are no denominations to you. There's no black church. There's no white church. There's no evangelicals. There's just us, your people, born again, children of God, gonna spend eternity with you. We pray over every minister of music, every church represented here tonight, that this coming weekend, next weekend, should you tarry and should we be alive, next Sunday, that you will give us the greatest blessing we've ever had in our churches. The best sermons, the best singing, the best praise and worship. Souls, draw them in that need to hear about your love. We commit everything we do, Lord, to you. You build the house. Unless the Lord builds the house, they that labor, absolutely labor in vain. But you're going to build your church. You promised it. We're going to work with you and for you. We pray it. In Jesus' name. Okay, and everyone said? Amen. So I want you to do two things. They're letting me close the meeting. So I want you to just turn to three people and give them a high five. Don't move. Just give a high five to three people. Come on. High five. Come on. Stay where you are. Just high five. Just a high five. I didn't say start a meaningful relationship. Just start a high five. Just a high five. Okay? So there's a song. Listen, if you want to leave, you can leave. We have no product. We didn't bring anything. If you want to get the choir's night of worship, and they have, what do you call that, other product. They have a hoodie. But I have a better hoodie. I wrote a book called Fan the Flame. And if you go to brooklyntabernacle.org, you can get the book at half price. And you can get all the And all the royalties go to the church. I don't get a dime for the books I write, the royalties. But I have a hoodie that says Fan the Flame. She, my wife, has a hoodie that's more artistic, and it says I Will Not Fear. But if you buy one of those, get two Fan the Flame, please, because I have to keep ahead. So they recorded a song which is just Sunday night church, clap your hands and move around. If you want to stay, stay and listen to it, be a part of it. If you have to leave, God bless you. It's called On My Way, On My Way. Ready? Let's give our hands together for the Brooklyn Tabernacle.